والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ونزلنا عليك الكتاب بيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين. صدق الله العظيم. سورة النحل of the Quran, Surah number 16, entitled The Bee. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the God of Adam alayhi salam, the God of Abraham alayhi salam, the God of Moses alayhi salam, the God of Jesus, the God who Jesus worshipped alayhi salam, and the God of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, and we sent down the book, namely the Quran, sent it down on thee, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, in order that this book might explain all things. And therefore that this book might explain the strange world in which we live today. The sun has never risen on a stranger world. That this book might explain the strangest thing of all in this strange world of ours. That strangest event in history, when Banu Israel, the Israelite people, who had been given the Holy Land, that the newspapers like to call Palestine, the Holy Land, and who had been expelled from that Holy Land by Allah Himself, and then had been prohibited from returning. They can come back as tourists, but you cannot come back to reclaim the Holy Land. For some 2,000 years, in a strangely scattered diaspora, suddenly, strangely, puzzlingly, mysteriously, mystifyingly, inexplicably, enigmatically, Banu Israel returned to the Holy Land
to reclaim it.
And a state of Israel appears on the map in the Holy Land. Only this book can explain it. And in this book, there is guidance. Guidance does not come from any other source, only from this book. That explanation and that guidance have come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an act of mercy and kindness, rahmah. And for those who have the good sense and the wisdom to go to the Quran and search for that explanation and guidance. And when they locate it, to accept it and to embrace it and to apply it. Bushra lahum, good news and glad tidings for such people. They will understand what others cannot. And they will succeed when others will not. We praise and we thank Allah, most kind, we glorify Him, and we pray to Him most humbly for His guidance and for His blessings and for His protection. As we attempt to address the subject, this awesomely important subject that all will benefit from listening to, Jerusalem in the Quran. Indeed, this has been the subject of my latest book, which I have just completed, Jerusalem in the Quran, Allahumma Jalla Jalalam. Jerusalem in the Quran, an Islamic view of the destiny of Jerusalem. This book has appeared in Penang about 2 weeks ago, and then in Hong Kong last week, and now Singapore. So we are using this opportunity, in fact, to launch this book in Singapore tonight. The subject begins in the Quran with a man named Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Prophet Abraham, who was thrown into the fire because he had the courage to proclaim the truth in the face of those who clung obstinately to falsehood. They threw him into the fire. I know an island where maybe he would have got a caning, but over there they threw him into the fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was so pleased with the servant of Allah who has stood up so courageously for the truth that Allah spoke to the fire and ordered the fire to be cool for him, to keep him safe. And then after that, the Quran declares, وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ وَلُوطًا إِلَى الْأَرْضِ الَّتِي بَارَكْنَا فِيهَا لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we delivered him to safety and took him and his nephew Lut alayhi salam to a land in which we had placed blessings for all of mankind. Allahumma rabba hadha al-bayt. We took him and his nephew Lut alayhi salam, the Prophet Lot, to a land in which we had placed blessings for all of mankind. This is the introduction in the Quran to the Holy Land. If blessings were placed in this land for all of mankind, then it follows therefrom that it must be for mankind who are living a particular way of life. But then the Quran takes up the subject after Banu Israel have been brought to the Holy Land. Ibrahim alayhi salam is now living there. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is tested. Take the mother, take the baby, take them out there in the desert, leave them there. No food, no water, no shelter, no security. The modern world would say that this is something irrational. But Ibrahim alayhi salam, once he is aware that this is the word of Allah, he submits. Whether he understands or he does not, whether he is comfortable with it or he is not, once it is the word of Allah, he submits. And this is for all of us present who believe in the one God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him a second time. Sacrifice your son. The modern world will say this is an irrational act. But not Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ya bunayya, he says to his son, إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَزْبَهُكَ. I have been commanded in a dream to sacrifice you. فَانْزُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Now son, what is your response? I'm ready, are you? And so whenever he is tested, he passes the test. Whenever we are tested, do we pass the test? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then conferred upon him a status. إني جاعلك للناس إماما. I hereby appoint you as the Imam of all of mankind, which includes, of course, the President of the United States. I hereby appoint you as the Imam of all of mankind. Now, I hope you would agree with me. If he is the Imam of all of mankind, then his religion is the religion of all of mankind. And therefore there can be only one true religion. And so we reject from this platform the claim that all religions are true. And it is a measure of tolerance that you accept that they are all true. We reject that because he is the Imam of all of mankind, and therefore there is only one true religion, and it is the religion of Abraham, alayhi salam. The Quran addresses Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and declares to him, ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ, and then we reveal to thee, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam, and اتَّبِعَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. You also, you must follow the religion of Abraham alayhi salam. So now we know that Abraham alayhi salam is brought to the Holy Land and settled in the Holy Land. And there are blessings in this Holy Land for all of mankind, indicating for all of mankind who follow the religion of Abraham, the one true religion. The Quran then takes up the subject many years later, after the Israelite people had been taken to Egypt and had lived there for some few centuries, and had been then enslaved in Egypt by the Pharaohs. And we don't have the time to give you that story, that interesting story tonight. And then Allah raised a man and commissioned him to go and struggle to deliver the Israelite people out of slavery in Egypt. This is the Prophet Moses, alayhi salam. And he came with the truth, and Pharaoh rejected it. He came with signs from Allah. Pharaoh rejected them. He warned him. Pharaoh disregarded the warning. Pharaoh persisted in his arrogant disdain for the truth which had come with Moses, alayhi salam, and clung to his own theory that he was the truth, and that his authority is the supreme authority, and that his law is the highest law. Sounds familiar today, doesn't it? And then when the moment came for the final showdown, and Allah ordered Moses, alayhi salam, and the Israelite people to flee, and then Pharaoh pursued them. And now the Israelite people, to use that quaint English expression, when they're almost to the sea, they were between the devil and the deep blue sea. Pharaoh and his army behind, and the deep blue sea in front of them. And so the enemy must have been rubbing his hands. We've cornered them now. We're going to finish them now. And this upstart who dares to challenge us, we who are drunk with power, we're going to finish them now. But Allah plans his plans when they plan their plans. And when Moses, alayhi salam, reached the water, then Allah ordered him, strike the water with your rod. And then Allah parted the sea. If he could do that yesterday, guess what we can do tomorrow. وَإِذْ فَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرِ We parted for you the sea. فَأَنْجَيْنَاكُمْ And we delivered you to safety. وَأَغْرَقْنَا آلَ فِرْعَامُ And that arrogant upstart out there who dares to challenge Allah's sovereignty and Allah's supreme authority and Allah's law of the highest law. We destroyed him. وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْزُرُونَ And it happened before your very eyes. And so now they are in Sinai, not the hospital in Manhattan. The desert. And then Moses goes up the mountain. Allah calls him up the mountain. Alayhi salam. And there he receives the Torah. But it came down, the beginning of the Ten Commandments in stone tablets. And then he came back down, and of course you know the story about the golden calf and so on. And then Moses, alayhi salam, he now gives the command to Banu Israel. He says, and this is Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا قَوْمِ ادْخُلُوا الْأَرْضَ الْمُقَدَّسَةَ الَّتِي كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ إِلَىٰ أَخِرِ الْآيَةِ O my people, come on. Let us fight, let us enter, let us take control of the holy land which Allah gave to you. If this is in the Quran, how come we don't hear them talking about it? How come the New York Times does not spread it on a full page? Sounds suspicious, doesn't it? There is a reason why they would not touch the Quran. Come on, let us enter and take control of the holy land which Allah gave to you. This is Surah Al-Ma'idah. But when they were given this command, and they came to learn that the people who lived in that land were a powerful people, Goliath, for example, they didn't have a stomach to fight. So they responded to their prophet and said to him, Oh no, we're not going. You and your Lord, both of you go and fight, we must stay right here. It is difficult for us to conceive of a people behaving so shamelessly, so insultingly, to the prophet who is their prophet and who is there in their midst. And to the Lord who has just parted the sea before their very eyes to deliver them to safety. It was insulting behavior. And the Quran teaches us that Allah responded. What did he do? He banned their entry into the Holy Land for how long? How long? 40 years. But wait a bit. The land had been given to them. But now they are banned from entering the Holy Land. So it seems as though the grant of the land was not unconditional. It seems as though the grant of the land was conditional. And when they violated the condition, he denied them the land. And so they are debarred for 40 years. And then Allah expresses his anger in the Quran. And he speaks to the heart of his prophet. Musa alayhi salam, Moses. And he says to him, فَلَا تَأْسَ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْفَاسِقِينَ Do not grieve over these sinful, wicked people. I remember, must have been a rabbi, I don't know, from Los Angeles, who started engaging me in emails back and forth on this subject. And then, I got an email, he says, don't you have any pity for us? So I replied with the Quran, where Allah himself said to his Prophet, do not grieve over a people who have acted in this manifestly sinful way. After the 40 years in the desert, and they all died in the desert, including Moses, alayhi salam, then the next generation after 40 years, they were allowed to enter into the Holy Land, and then they fought under Joshua, for example. And then under David, alayhi salam, they were able to consolidate themselves as a kingdom. And he, the prophet, is also a king. We have a prophet king. He is the founder of the state of Israel. It is an Islamic state because his religion is Islam, meaning a religion of submission to Allah as sovereign, a religion of submission to Allah's authority as supreme, a religion of submission to Allah's law as the highest law. This is Islam. The state of Israel under David, alayhi salam, expands and it becomes a powerful state. And then under his son Sulaiman, alayhi salam, the Prophet Solomon, its power is further consolidated. And he also builds the masjid, which they call the temple, Masjid al-Aqsa. And if you read the Quran about that encounter between Solomon alayhi salam and the Queen of Sheba, Bilqis from Yemen, you will see implicit in that exchange between the two the recognition, this is very important now, listen, that Israel was the ruling state in the world. What is the definition of a ruling state? It is a state which can impose its will on any rival. Israel is the ruling state in the world because no one can stand up to Israel and defy Israel. This is, therefore, the golden age. A golden age in which we, as the followers of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, we share in the joy of that golden age. It is as much our golden age as the golden age of Banu Israel. Because David alayhi salam is our prophet, as well as their prophet. And Solomon alayhi salam is our prophet, as well as their prophet. But after the death of Solomon alayhi salam, it is then that internal conflict led to civil war, and the state is now broken up into two. There is a northern state which is called Israel, and then there's a southern state which is called Judah. And in the internal rivalry between the rabbis of the north and the rabbis of the south, it is now that we have what the Quran has described in great detail, the rewriting of the word of Allah. The Torah which had come down from Allah is rewritten several times. An example is given in the Quran. Allah had prohibited usury, riba, the lending of money on interest, prohibited. And then revelation came down in which the Quran declared about the Jews and about the Christians, and remember, this lecture is based firmly on the Quran and on the word of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam. Firmly based on it. And of course, we must have the freedom wherever we are in the world. No one can deny us that freedom to teach the Quran and to teach the word of the Prophet. And so the Quran declares, اتخذوا أهبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They took their priests and their rabbis as lords and gods beside Allah. والمسيح ابن مريم, and they did the same thing with the Messiah, the son of Mary. وما أمروا إلا يعبدوا إلها واحد, but they had not been commanded other than to worship one God. لا إله إلا هو, there is no God beside him. سبحانه, glory be to him, عما يشركون, far removed is he from this act of shirk, this act of blasphemy, of taking the priests and rabbis as lords and gods beside Allah. When this verse of the Quran was revealed, a man came to the Prophet Muhammad and said, O Messenger of Allah, but the Christians don't worship their priests, and the Jews don't worship their rabbis. How could Allah say so? The Prophet responded and said, did they not make halal what Allah made haram? Did they not legalize? Is it not legal now to lend money on interest? That is their shirk. Whoever legalizes what Allah has made prohibited has committed the one sin that Allah will never forgive, the act of shirk. If you legalize the lending of money and interest, for example, you have committed the sin called shirk. And then he said, did the people not accept it? That is their shirk. When we go to the Quran now informs us that they made halal the lending of money on interest, which Allah had made haram. He says that in Surah An-Nisa. وَأَخْذِهِمُ الرِّبَى. They were taking riba, the interest on the money that they had lent. وَقَدْ نُهُوا عَنْهُ, even though it had been made prohibited for them. When we go to the Torah now, then we find in the Torah that someone had rewritten the word of Allah. And the Torah now declares that it is haram for an Israelite to lend money on interest to another Israelite. But it is halal, it is permissible for him to lend money on interest to those who are not Israelites. That didn't come from Allah. The Quran is telling us they wrote that with their own hands. Because of this rewriting of the Torah, and a lot of this information you will find in my book outside entitled The Religion of Abraham and the State of Israel, a view from the Quran. Because of this rewriting of the Torah, this awesome sin of shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now expels them from the Holy Land. And he speaks of this at the beginning of Surah to Bani Israel, which is Surah number 17. وَقَضَيْنَا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ وَلَتَعْلُنَّ عُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. It was ordained that Banu Israel will commit this awesome facade in the Holy Land on two occasions. This is the first one, making halal what Allah had made haram and changing the word of Allah. And then he sent an army which worshipped the sun and the moon and the stars, the Babylonian army. And this army attacked that state of Israel, defeated it, destroyed it, destroyed the masjid, and took Banu Israel back to Babylon as slaves. But wait a minute, the land had been given to them. How come they are now expelled from the land? Allah did it. It seems as though the land was not given to them unconditionally. It seems very clear that the land was given to them conditionally, that there were conditions attached, and that they had violated those divine conditions. And when you violate the divine condition, even the President of the United States can't help you. Now let us see whether our theory or our hypothesis is correct. Let us go to Surah Al-Anbiya, where Allah speaks and He says, وَلَقَدْ كَتَبْنَا فِي الزَّبُورِ مِنْ بَعْدِ الذِّكْرِ أَنَّ الْأَرْضَ يَرِثُهَا عِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحُونَ. And we sent it down in the Psalms of David alayhi salam. And that came after we had sent it down in the Zikr, which is the Torah, which came to Moses alayhi salam. What did we send now? أَنَّ الْأَرْضَ يَرِثُهَا عِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحُونَ. That only those who are my servants, and therefore who follow the religion of the Imam who I pointed, the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, which is Islam, only those who are my servants and who are righteous in their conduct, only they will inherit the Holy Land. Some people have difficulties in understanding what is righteousness. So maybe this lecture has come as an opportune moment for us to teach them what is righteousness. It is not righteousness that you turn your faces to this way or to that way. That's not righteousness. Righteousness is in your conduct. And if you drive a people out of their homes and out of the land in which they lived, for no just cause other than they are Muslims, you drive them out, and then you deny them for 50 long years. You deny them the right to return. That is not righteousness. Allah says in Surah Al-Hajj, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ. الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم بغير حق إلا أن يقولوا ربنا الله. That when a people are driven out of their homes and out of the land in which they live, for no just cause other than they are Muslims, Allah gives them permission to wage war. Allah gives them permission to wage war. In order to respond to this oppression. And Allah says that when you wage war, Allah is sufficient to come to your help so that you will eventually be victorious. And so one of the conditions for inheritance of the Holy Land is that you must be a servant of Allah, therefore following the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Number two, condition for inheritance of the Holy Land is that you must be righteous in your conduct. Not righteousness as defined by the Security Council of the UN. Righteousness as defined by the one who created all of mankind. Because they violated these conditions, they were thrown out of the Holy Land. But when we go to the Torah, we find that someone changed the word of Allah on this subject. And you'll find this quote in my book, The Religion of Abraham and the State of Israel. You'll also find it, of course, in this book. It is not because of righteousness that the Lord your God has given you this good land to inherit it. No. No. Not because of righteousness. Because you are a stiff-necked people. That is what is in the Torah. Implication of this statement is that whether you are righteous or you are not, the land is still yours. Whether you follow the religion of Abraham or you abandon it, the land is still yours. That is the implication. That is false. And so now they are in Babylon, you remember? Weeping by the rivers of Babylon. And then Allah sent prophets to them, because they're still living as a homogeneous community. Among the prophets who were sent to them is, of course, the famous prophet Daniel, and then there is Isaiah. And these prophets communicate a divine promise. A divine promise. Listen carefully to this promise, because this is at the heart of Jerusalem in the Quran. The promise is still there in the Torah, you can read it, in the Jewish scriptures, that Allah was going to send a prophet who will be known as the Messiah, Al-Masih. And when the Messiah comes, he will rule the world from the throne of David, alayhi salam, and therefore the state of Israel. And therefore, Jerusalem, which is the capital city. And so when the Messiah comes, the Messiah will rule the world from Jerusalem. And secondly, that when the Messiah rules the world from Jerusalem, his rule will be eternal. And therefore, this will be the end of history. Not what Francis Fukuyama wrote. This is the end of history, when the Messiah comes. Now, if you're in Babylon, and you get this promise from Allah, then the inescapable implications, you don't need a PhD from MIT to deduce this, is number one, in order for the Messiah to rule the world from Jerusalem, the first thing that the Messiah will do when he comes, or will have to do, would be number one, he'll have to liberate the Holy Land. Having liberated the Holy Land of Babylonian rule, the second thing that he'll have to do would be to bring the Israelite people back to the Holy Land. The third thing that he'll have to do would be to restore the state of Israel. The fourth thing he'll have to do would be to ensure that that state of Israel becomes once again the ruling state in the world, once again. And so the golden age will come back. And then the Messiah can rule the world from Jerusalem. And so while they're weeping by the rivers of Babylon, they're waiting for that day when the Holy Land would be liberated. And then there was an awesomely important change in international relations. The Persian Empire defeated Babylon. And the Persian king, then having liberated the Holy Land of Babylonian rule, then ordered that the Jews be allowed to return to the Holy Land. Not as tourists, but to reclaim it. And that the temple or the masjid be reconstructed. And so when Banu Israel returned to the Holy Land and the temple was rebuilt, there is expectancy in the air. The Messiah must be around the corner. Everybody is talking about it. Messiah must be around the corner. And then Allah raised a man. Oh, he was a very strange man. You can't find such a man in Singapore anymore. He used to wear clothing of animal skin. And he used to eat wild berries and honey and so on. And when he spoke from the heart. It wasn't just words. And the truth came out of him, because in his heart there was light. Singapore, are you listening? In his heart there was light. You can't buy that light in the stock market. And this man began to proclaim the truth. And this man began to denounce them for their betrayal of the religion of Abraham alayhi salam, and call them back to the right path. But it was like the voice of one crying in the wilderness. The rabbis wouldn't listen to him. And then this man began to proclaim, the Messiah is coming. Or when he spoke those words, it was like electricity in the air. It spread like wildfire. The Messiah is coming. And then one day, when the Messiah, who is now a grown-up man, came back to the Holy Land, he came directly in front of that man. And then when that man saw him, he said, here he is. This is the man you've been waiting for. This is the Messiah, the son of Mary. Who was that man? John the Baptist, Yahya alayhi salam. I told you, double it, can't find people like that anymore. For when they speak from the heart, and who have light in their hearts. And when they call the people to come back to the truth and to the path of righteousness, it's like the voice of one crying in the wilderness. But when he said, this is the man you've been waiting for, this is the Messiah, then Jesus, the son of Mary, responded and he says, yes, I am the Messiah. And then the Quran declares, فَآمَنَ طَائِفَةٌ مِّن بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. Part of the Israelite people accepted him as the Messiah and they believed in him as the Messiah. Yes, they did. These are the poor. These are the ones who are humble and lowly in the spirit. These are the innocent at heart. وَكَفَرَ طَائِفَةٌ. But another part of Banu Israel rejected him. This is the elite. This is the administration. This is the establishment. This is the rabbis. They rejected him. Why did they reject him? Number one, when I would be learning Hazar, he's a bastard. A bastard cannot be the Messiah. Why? His mother was the most famous girl in all the land. The most pious, the most virtuous, the most learned girl in all the land, Mary, who had lived in the temple itself, in the masjid, under the guardianship of the chief rabbi, Zachariah himself, from age 2 until she reached the age of puberty. She now has the monthly cycle, so she can no longer live in the masjid. When that child was in that masjid, I tell you, those rabbis must have had a lot of fun. They must have enjoyed having her in the masjid, particularly Zachariah alayhi salam. In those days, the masjid was built differently from today. The mihrab was not a little niche in the wall in the direction of the Kaaba. The mihrab was a separate room called the Holy of Holies. And only the chief rabbi could enter that room. And in that room were the sacred relics, like for example, the Burak. So Mary was allowed into that room because Zachariah alayhi salam had guardianship over her. One day he entered into the mihrab and he found her with food. Mary, where did you get that food? So the little girl responded, I asked for it. He sent it to me. The old man must have taken off his hat and scratched his head. She asked. He sent it. I want a son. I should also ask. And then he went into the mihrab himself when he was all alone and he asked. And then the angel appeared to him and said, your prayer has been answered. You will have a son and his name is going to be John. Yahya alayhi salam. Now the whole world knew about this. And so Mary is a very famous girl. One day she disappears. She had left the temple and she's now living with her parents. One day she disappears. And then after a few months she returns and she has a baby. And when they ask her, Mary, whose baby is this? She points to the baby. She knows. Oh yes, she knows. Because the angel told her this baby is going to be the Messiah. So she knows. But it is a part of the divine plan that she is not to speak. She points to the baby. They said, Mary, how can a baby speak? For the baby spoke. Quran declares the baby spoke. But when the baby spoke and proclaimed, I am the messenger of Allah, they said, هذا سحر مبين. Pure magic. And so they denounced her. They declared of her that she had committed that vile deed of fornication because she's not married. How can you have a baby? This happens when you see with only one eye. Had they been seeing with two eyes, not one, you know the second eye, the heart can see. Had they been seeing with two eyes, the external and the internal, they would have asked themselves a question. No one knew she was pregnant. No one knew. When the baby was born, well, why didn't she not get rid of it? Give it up for adoption. Put it in front of somebody's front door and run away. In New York, they put it in a garbage bin. Why did she not do that? She didn't do that. She came back with the baby. She didn't come in the nighttime. She came in the daytime. She didn't come through the back road. She came through the front road. She didn't come with the baby behind her. She came with the baby in front of her. This is not normal behavior. There is more to this than meets the eye. So let us hesitate. Let us pause before we rush to judgment. Let us try to get to the bottom of this. But they didn't do that because they were seeing with only one eye, internally dead, internally blind. And so they rejected him. He cannot be the Messiah because he's a bastard. And then when the son of Mary began to denounce them, among other things, for their riba, I can't explain to you now, it would take too much time. It's not the lending of money on interest, it's another form of riba. The Americans have a beautiful expression for this form of riba, they call it a rip-off. Rip-off. In the exchange of money. He denounced them. He caught them in the temple itself, the masjid, engaged in riba. He cursed them. He turned over their tables. He threw them out of the masjid. He declared, you've taken the house of Allah and you've transformed it into a den of thieves. Today the modern world will say, he's a terrorist. Yes, that is their polluted thinking. They decided this man must die. They held a kangaroo court. And they sentenced him to death. And then they forced the hand of a reluctant Roman government to crucify. And then they saw him die on the cross. Before their very eyes, they saw him die. When they saw him die on the cross, now it was as plain and as clear as daylight. He could not have been the Messiah. What? He's dead. But he didn't rule the world from Jerusalem with a rule which is eternal. And so now they boasted. This is in the Quran, and therefore I have the right to quote it. They boasted. We have killed him, the son of Mary, the Messiah, of course this is sarcasm because they rejected him, the messenger of Allah, وَقَوْلِهِمْ إِنَّا قَتَلْنَا الْمَسِيحَ عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. This is the word of Allah in the Quran. So you can't sue me. We'll kill him. Therefore, he could not have been the Messiah. And so they're now waiting for the Messiah to come. Can't live in New York and not know that. What they did not know, and no one knew until the Quran was revealed, no one knew, was that no, they did not kill him. No, they did not crucify him. Allah made it appear unto them that this is what happened. What is the explanation of what happened on the cross? It is here in this book. I don't have the time to give it to you. And then Allah raised him unto himself. So he did not experience what is known as maut. When Allah takes the soul and does not return it, then that is called maut. Allah raised him without his experiencing maut. But Allah says in the Quran, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِكَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul must taste maut. Every soul must die. And therefore he has to return one day. Yes, the son of Mary is coming back. The most powerful voice in all of history to prophesy the return of Jesus alayhi salam is the voice of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's given us detailed information concerning the event of the return, on the basis of which it is possible for me to make a calculated guess and to arrive at a figure that he is going to return perhaps within the next 50 years. But they didn't know that. So they're waiting for the Messiah to come. When he comes back, this is precisely what he's going to do. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, he's going to go to Jerusalem. Jerusalem. And in Jerusalem, he would be Hakimun Adil, a ruler, ruling the world from Jerusalem with justice. And that would be a rule which would be eternal. And that would therefore be the end of history, in the sense that there is nothing to come after that to replace it. And so they are back. They are there in Jerusalem and they are waiting for the Messiah to come. Because this could not have been the Messiah, he's dead. The Quran now takes up this story from here. And what follows now, the second part of this lecture, is the more important part for you. Because in this second part of the lecture, you're getting an Islamic view of the destiny of Jerusalem that even the Security Council of the UN doesn't know about. First of all, Allah expels them from the Holy Land. The first time it was the Babylonian army, worshipping the sun and the moon and the stars. This time it's the Roman army, worshipping a goddess named Venus, and a god named Zeus, and a god named Mars. They are expelled from the Holy Land, but this expulsion differs from the previous one. This time Allah says in Suratul A'raf, وَقَطَّعْنَاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُمَمٌ. We broke them up into bits and pieces and scattered them everywhere. And so Jews in Argentina and Jews in China and Jews in Egypt, and Jews in Russia, and Jews in Yemen, and Jews in Iraq, and Jews in Iran, and Jews in Morocco. This is divine punishment. But the rabbi says this was the divine wisdom, so that the truth could reach all of mankind. وَقَطْعَنَاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُمَمًا. We broke them up into bits and pieces and scattered them everywhere. The second thing that Allah says is that He is a God of mercy and compassion. And so even though they committed this vilest of all deeds in attempting to crucify the Messenger of Allah, and even though they had killed Zakaria alayhi salam in the masjid itself, and even though Yahya alayhi salam was beheaded, the killing of the prophets, yet he says, Asa Rabbukum an yarhamakum. It is still possible that your Lord can forgive you. It is still possible that your Lord can have mercy on you. There is only one door to mercy. What is it? At the end of Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us of the door to mercy for Banu Israel. He says, those who follow the messenger, who will be Al-Ummi, Nabi Al-Ummi, meaning the prophet who could not read and write, and also meaning the prophet who is not a Jew, he's a Gentile. Those who follow that prophet, whom they will find mentioned in the Torah as well as in the Gospel. And therefore, the Quran is speaking to a Banu Israel after they had attempted to crucify Isa alayhi salam. Those who follow that prophet, who they will find mentioned in the Torah as well as in the Injil, the Gospel, who will command them what is just, and who will forbid them what is evil, who will allow them as lawful as halal, what is good and pure, and who will prohibit them as haram, that which is impure, who will release them from the heavy yokes and burdens which were upon them. It is those who believe in that prophet, namely the prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. It is those who believe in him. فَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِهِ وَعَذَّرُوهُ, and who honor him, وَنَصَرُوا, and who help him, وَاتَّبَعُوا النُّورَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ مَعَهُ, and who follow the light which came down with him, namely the Quran. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. These are the ones who will prosper. These are the ones who will earn Allah's mercy. And so the door to mercy is Muhammad alayhi salam. And so when the hijrah took place, and that prophet has now arrived in Medina, and the cream of Jewish scholarship is in Medina, and Rabbi, what are you doing in Medina, an Arabian city? The rabbi would reply and say, well, our prophets told us that that prophet who is going to be coming will come to this city. That is why we are here. So when the prophet Muhammad arrived in Medina after the hijrah, the window of opportunity is now open for Banu Israel. If they accept him as the prophet of Allah, Allah will forgive them. He makes it easy for them to accept him. He makes it easy for them to recognize that the same God who sent Moses alayhi salam is the same God who has now sent Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He's made it easy for them because he performs his prayer in the direction of their Qibla. He turns towards Jerusalem, not Mecca, for prayer. That was difficult for an Arab. Secondly, he fasts with them on the days when they fasted and in accordance with their law of fasting. You know what is their law of fasting? You begin the fast at sunset. And you fast all through the night and all through the next day. No food, no water. And you couldn't go to your wives during the night. That was real difficult for the Arabs. Real difficult. So he fasted with them on the days when they fasted and in accordance with their law of fasting. To make it easy for them to recognize that the same God who has sent down the Torah is the same God who is now sending down the Quran. But after 17 months in Medina, it has now become plain as daylight that they have rejected Muhammad alayhi salam, the Arab, as the Prophet of Allah. And they have rejected the Quran as divine revelation. It has become plain as daylight that they are now openly conspiring to destroy Islam. This is there in the books of Sirah. This is not fiction, this is history. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did something momentous in history. He changed the Qibla. Turn away from Jerusalem. Turn now to Mecca. So the door is closed. You had your chance and you blew it. Turn now to Mecca. The window of opportunity is closed. And he declared, Tilka ummatun qad khalat. That religious community is now history. Dismissed. And he declared of this one, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You are the best, which we have raised for the benefit of mankind, provided that muruna bil ma'ruf. You enjoin what is just and what is right, regardless of the price you have to pay. وَتَنْهَوْنَا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And you struggle against that which is false and unjust, regardless of the price you have to pay. If you do that, you are the best to have been raised for the benefit of mankind. And so now the door is closed for Banu Israel. They can no longer earn Allah's mercy. What punishment is now waiting for them? Allah speaks again in Surah Al-A'raf. And he declares, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكَ لَيَبْعَثَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ يَسُومُهُمْ سُوءَ الْعَذَابِ. And your Lord has announced that he is now going to raise against them those who will inflict upon them until the last day the worst possible punishment. When the Quran speaks, you better listen. Who are those who are now going to be raised? Who will now continue in their struggle until the end of history? And who will inflict upon Banu Israel the worst possible punishment? Who are they? The Quran itself answers and tells us about the first. There are two of them. Two who will be raised. I now come to Surah Al-Anbiya, and there are two verses. It is somewhere around 94, 95, 96. And I would urge you when you go back home to go find these two verses in Surah Al-Anbiya. Anbiya is number 21, Surah number 21. Allah speaks about a town, the town, which He destroyed. And the people were expelled from that town. And then they were banned from returning. They could come back as tourists, that's okay, but they cannot come back to reclaim that town as theirs. Until and unless Gog and Magog are released. And when they are released, they spread out in every direction. Then these people will be brought back to reclaim that town. Let us quote the Arabic. وَحَرَامٌ عَلَى قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا أَنَّهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ حَتَّى إِذَا فُتِحَتْ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَدَبٍ يَنْسِلُونَ Question 1. Which town is it? Question 2. Ooh, Agag and Magog. The Prophet said, God or Ya'juj is an ummah of Banu Adam. So they're human beings. He said, Ma'juj is an ummah of Banu Adam. So Gog and Magog are human beings, just like you and I. However, Gog and Magog differ from you and I because of a hadith in Sahih Muslim, Hadith al-Qudsi, in which Allah says, I have created creatures of mine so powerful that none but I can destroy them. And so when they are released, Gog and Magog, with their indestructible power, they'll take control of the world. They will establish the world order of Gog and Magog. And since their power is indestructible, only Allah can destroy, it would appear to Francis Fukuyama that this is the end of history. When Gog and Magog are released, then they will use their power, their control over the world is spread out in all directions. And now you will see the people of this town being brought back to the town to reclaim it. Which town is it? We have now come to a crucial part of our subject, Jerusalem in the Quran.